Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is part two from Women and Perfume. My dear sisters and my brothers, it is well known that Al-Islam in its last formation was brought to us by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Al-Islam as a religion was born with our father Adam alayhi salam and reached its utmost completion at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And since he was also a guide and a teacher, he also helped us understand the ambiguous things and he made them clear. There is also a very precise and fundamental rule that our scholars have understood from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they refer to it as لا يجوز تأخير البيان عن وقت الحاجة. In English, it is not permitted for our messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to delay clarification when it is mostly needed, meaning that Rasulullah ﷺ cannot keep quiet when something is wrong in front of him, because if he does that, it means that he has accepted the thing as the norm. For Allah has warned in His noble book, in the Quran, in Surah Al-Ma'idah. And Surah Al-Ma'idah, my dear sisters and my brothers, is the surah in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala laid down foundation and warnings for a strong nations. All the Quran before Surah Al-Ma'idah was revealed to Muslims in state of fear, fight, weakness. Except Surah Al-Ma'idah, it holds a completely different tune to it, and that is now you Muslims have become a powerful nation, so watch out. And in Surah Al-Ma'idah as a whole, Allah calls on the believers, Ya أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا 16 times. And He warned us time after time after time, and He gave us examples of those who abused the power. And you would think we would learn from it, but sadly we did not. Surah Al-Ma'idah, my sisters and my brothers, was revealed in year 10 when Rasulullah ﷺ went to Al-Hajj. 90 days later, Rasulullah ﷺ died. So even though Al-Ma'idah is ranked number 5 in the holy book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran, but it was, as I said, revealed in year 10. So 23 years after the birth of Islam. And you can see the conclusion when you go there. It's a beautiful surah, only if it was studied the way it should have been. But in here, in this surah, Allah speaking and warning the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and He tells him something that is extremely chilling, blood freezing. He says, Ya ayyuhar rasul, messenger, balligh ma unzila ilayka min rabbik, convey what has been descended to you from your Lord, i.e. the Quran. Wa illam taf'al, and if you don't do, فما بلغت رسالته, then you haven't conveyed His message at all. And this ayah is number 67. What Allah tells the Prophet ﷺ, the messenger, is that he must convey the whole of the Quran, the teachings and everything. If he misses one thing that Rasulullah ﷺ has not clarified or conveyed to us, it equals as if he has not conveyed anything of Islam at all. And this is why today in the masjids and everything, you always hear them, wa adda al-amana, and he has conveyed the trust. It's kind of like we witness, Ya Allah, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has conveyed all the trust that we have given to him, and that is Al-Quran. And you would think we would put the Quran number one. And all the headaches about the perfume and so many other issues are because we have put the Quran way behind our back. So let us see if our messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been in a situation where he found himself in presence with a perfumed woman and how he dealt with it. And the hadith is reported by our mother Aisha in Sunan Abi Dawood. And Al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah, when he analyzed this hadith, he said, Isnaduhu sahih. So the chain of narrators is authentic. So she said, Kunna nakhruju ma'an Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ila Makkah. We were out on our journey to Mecca for Hajj. Fanudammida jibahana bisukki al-mutayyib. We would paste on our foreheads a perfume called as-suk. What they used to do before, they used to make this suk. Suk is kind of like a paste, but that paste is scented. It's like the perfume today. You know when you've got the cream, ladies, you put the the body cream, the scented body cream nicely, things like that. Usually it's sold with very expensive perfumes. At that time there, they couldn't make the perfume unless they brought them from elsewhere, but they could make up a paste. So our mother Aisha radiallahu anha explains to us how they used that perfumed scented paste. She said they used to paste it on their foreheads. And then what they do is, and as I said, it's called as-suk. And then she says, before al-ihram, before they go in the state of al-ihram for hajj. And then she said, فَإِذَا عَرَقَتْ إِحْدَانَا سَالَ عَلَى وَجِهَا. So that when they are performing the hajj, so that when one of us perspired, like they sweated, then guess what? The perfume would come down on their face. Subhanallah. And then she said something extremely important. She said, فَيَرَاهُ النَّبِيُّ فَلَا يَنْهَانَا. And the Prophet would see it and he would not forbid us from doing it. So Rasulullah ﷺ, what this means is, the ladies at the time of Rasulullah ﷺ, and this is his wife Aisha, explains to us that they would make a paste called as-sulk. They make it and it's very nicely scented. And then they would take it from them to Hajj. And before entering the state of al-Ihram, they would paste it on their forehead and put whatever it is that they put on them. You know what the women, they put like turbans over the head? So that when they sweat of the heat and the water start coming down, it would pass through that paste and then it becomes, the sweat becomes scented so that they'll stink. And Rasulullah ﷺ sees them and guess what? He wouldn't forbid them from doing that. What this also means is, if they did it before the stage of ihram, so that when they are in ihram, they would not stink, means that they used to do it before also. And that's how he learned about it, and that's how they knew the trick and everything. And again, my sisters, as you can see here, in Sunan Abu Dawud, now someone might say, hang on, this is just in Abu Dawud. You know, some people, they will argue with you to death to prove to you that you are wrong in what you're saying. Well, guess what? There is another statement of Imam Shafi'i alayhi rahmatullah. He goes, حُكْمُ الْمَرْأَةِ فِي اسْتِحْبَابِ التَّطَيُّبِ لِلْإِحْرَامِ كَحُكْمِ الرَّجُلِ. The ruling of a woman performing al-ihram, who is going to perform al-hajj. So, because man before entering in the state of ihram, it is recommended for us. They say it's sunnah, and it's good, and it's best, and it's nice, and it's lovely, and everything, that we put perfume before we enter in the state of ihram. Because once the ihram starts, we can't put perfume. Guess what? Al-Shafi'i ala rahmatullah, one of the great scholars, says that also applies to women. And this is called in Hudyat al-Ulama, and like the jewel of the scholars, by where they put all the school of thoughts and the debates and things like that. And this is an agreed matter. Some people would say, hang on, this is for Hajj. And we're going to kind of like go blind with it, because really it's a headache how much people go to prove something and they will take it out of context. The next hadith will highlight and will give us more light about this issue. And this hadith here is in Abu Dawud, in Muslim, in Al-Bukhari as well. So this hadith is the highest of what you can get your hands on when it comes to the authenticity of the hadith, since it's mentioned in Muslim and Al-Bukhari alayhim rahmatullah, and also in Abi Dawud. Anna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abdullah ibn Abbas says, Anna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, kharaja yawma adha aw fitr. That Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went out on a Adha day or Fitr day. So they don't remember exactly which is which. And this is why I tell you the hadith is 99% always reported to us by meaning only. It's not a revelation from Allah. Always bear this in mind. So as you can see here, the Sahaba are not sure which was it, Adha or Fitr. But what matters is that Rasulullah ﷺ went out on an Adha or Fitr day. فصلى ركعتين لم يصلي قبلها ولا بعدها. So he prayed two rak'at and did not pray any sunnah before or after, like the Salat al-Eid, you pray two rak'at. ثم أتى النساء. Then he went to the women, ومعه بلال. And with him was Bilal, the Sahabi عليه رحمة الله. And then Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم فأمرهن بالصدقة. And then he encouraged them to donate صدقة. Bilal says, فجعلت المرأة تلقي خرصها وصخبها. And then the women began to give their rings and jewelry and pieces of jewelry and necklaces and things like that. And then they said something extremely important. Sahabaha. The word sahaba, when you look in the books of English translations, they will just put necklace. Even in the Arabic books, especially where the strong opinion is that women do not go outside perfumed, they will always hide a meaning. They play with the meaning of this hadith so that people think wrong or think other than what is really happened. A sahab, they will always say, is qilada. It's a necklace that woman puts around her neck, right? And you would go, oh, that's it. But actually, no. A sahab is a necklace especially designed to carry perfume. Before, they didn't have the perfume that you put on today. So what women did, they wore a necklace with a special box, small box, and in that box they put perfume. And when someone stands in front of them to talk to them, they would smell that nice perfume. That is what's called sahab. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to these women and told them to donate charity, sadaqah, women took their rings, their bracelets and things like that, and also they took their perfume necklaces that they wore. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not only he didn't say anything to them, but he accepted that as an act of charity. He took their perfume boxes that they used to hang around the neck. And this hadith in Bukhari, Muslim, and Abu Dawud is a clear evidence that the companions, the women there, used to wear perfume. But obviously, because they want to make it seem like at the time of Rasulullah, no woman wore perfume, they all stink and all they just smell horrible, so that they can pass it to you like it's salaf, a salih, the righteous predecessors, they hate the meanings of this hadith. And I pray to Allah to take His vengeance against these people who have hidden agendas. To bring it all together, my dear sisters and my brothers, and to truly understand the issue of women and perfume, we need first to set our feet on solid ground to be able to move forward. Moving sands cannot enable us to move forward steadily and strongly. So the first solid ground that should have been and is and should be is the Quran. The Quran should have been the very first source from which any matter must be proven right or wrong, belief or disbelief, halal or haram. The demoralizing catastrophe and the sadness of the saddest of news is that the primary source, the Quran, is hardly ever consulted first. This is why in this issue here and many, many others, the very first thing you hear or read is Qala Rasulullah. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, so and so scholar said. We hear the messenger, but we never hear who sent the messenger, what he has to say in all this. It's not possible that we speak about how much Rasulullah has spoken and hardly ever what Allah has spoken. Hardly ever you hear people speak about the issue of women and perfume, go to the Quran first. And this is a problem. Even though Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has described this Quran in the most beautiful and the most comprehensive of terms that you can ever imagine. Look at this surah here, or this ayah here, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَنَزَّلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابِ, and we gradually descended upon you the book, on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, تِبْيَانًا لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ, a clarification to everything. And I want you to put 1 million lines under clarification to everything, i.e. in the Quran is the clarification of everything that you need to access and gain Jannah. Whatever will guide us inside Jannah is in Al-Quran. Nothing else is needed. Wallahi al-Azim, nothing else. And he has made a mistake. You see, the problem is, we have one scholar, Al-Awza'i, Allah forgive him for what he said. He said that Al-Quran needs the Sunnah to explain it far more than the Sunnah needs Al-Quran. One man made one mistake, and then thousands upon other thousands of people kept repeating what he said until it has become a fact. today people believe that Al-Quran without the Sunnah cannot be understood. When Allah says, تِبْيَانَ لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ وَنَزَّلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابِ, and we, نَزَّلَ is gradually descend something. So Allah says, and we gradually descended upon you the book, which is Al-Quran, a clarification to everything. You know what the danger is? The other day, people from the Salafi world, from the Saudis and all this, wallahi al-adim, sometimes I think how much of Islam is there. They were writing articles to prove that Al-Quran is not a clarification of everything. Allah says, tibyana likulli shay, clarification to everything, and people are writing article saying it is not. And guess what is the very first argument they gave? Where in Al-Quran do you find that Dhuhr is 4 rak'at? Where do you find in Al-Quran that Maghrib is 3 rak'at? Is this the only thing? We all know that when Rasulullah ﷺ, after the ascension, Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj and everything, when he came back, the very next day, Jibreel ﷺ came. And when we say Jibreel came, Jibreel doesn't come from his own pocket. Jibreel comes only by the command of Allah. Jibreel came physically to Rasulullah ﷺ and he taught him how to perform a salat. Even in our books of fiqh, Jibreel stood and Rasulullah stood behind him to be led in a salat. Jibreel prayed and Rasulullah ﷺ prayed after behind Jibreel. That's how Rasulullah ﷺ learned how many rak'at are the dhuhr. This is why Rasulullah ﷺ, since he became prophet, has performed salat. He never stopped. In Mecca, they performed salat. But we don't have that form, how they performed salat, because that salat was not prescribed by Allah. It was what Rasulullah ﷺ had figured out by himself. And Allah left him like that. But when it became on Muslims that we had to carry it, Allah sent Jibreel to teach Rasulullah ﷺ how many rak'at are in Dhuhr, how many rak'at in Maghrib, and how do we pray, and everything it was taught. As Allah says in the Quran, عَلَّمَهُ شَدِيدُ الْقُوَى. The one who taught Rasulullah ﷺ is extremely powerful and extremely strong. So the argument of, oh, without the Sunnah we wouldn't know how many rak'at we pray Dhuhr, is absolutely a fake argument through which they penetrate and use the Sunnah for everything else. Everything else, and I say everything else. So Allah says, وَنَزَّلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابِ, and we gradually descended upon you the book, تِبْيَانًا لِكُلِّ شِيءٍ, a clarification to everything, وَهُدًا, and a guidance, وَرَحْمَةً, and a mercy, وَبُشْرَى لِلْمُسْلِمِينَ, and a happy news to the Muslims. And Muslims here, it doesn't mean you and me. It means anyone who is subservient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we will see this later on when I talk about Islam. This ayah exists in Surah An-Nahl, that is the surah number 16. And I will let you know, if you speak Arabic, you will think like An-Nahl is the bee, the An-Nahla. And if you go to your Quran in the translation of the meanings in English, and you go to the surah number 16, and when you read there, you will find that the Nahl will translate into the bee that gives honey. But actually, the surah's name is wrong. People got it wrong. And Nahl is more of gifts, donations, bounties, and everything that Allah extends to us. And in Arabic, the term Nahalahu Shay'an, meaning he gave him that thing. So An-Nahl, Surah An-Nahl, in it Allah mentions all the gifts that Allah has given to us. So much that so the scholars call it Surah An-Ni'am. It's the surah of the bounties. And we turned it onto just a B. But anyhow, what this ayah means about Allah sending down the Quran, which is tibyana li kulli shay, clarification to everything, is that it has everything that humanity needs to be subservient to Allah as Allah wants. Because this is why on Judgment Day, Allah will ask, alam takun ayati tutla alaykum? Wasn't my ayat from the Quran being recited on you? On the judgment day, there will be no Bukhari, there'll be no Muslim, there'll be no books of hadith, there'll be no scholar. The only criteria by which Allah will hold you responsible on judgment day is the Quran, and the Quran only. You cannot tell him, Ya Allah, I read this in Al-Bukhari, and you can certainly not say it's been authenticated by Al-Albani. On Judgment Day, Al-Albani himself will run away from you. He will tell you, leave me alone. Only the Quran will stand on Judgment Day. And if Allah wanted to prohibit women from wearing perfume, He would have said it in the Quran, Ya أيها الذين أو يا أيتها المؤمنات, those who have believed about the ladies, لا تقربوا العطر, do not approach perfume or whatever it is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't say anything at all. Subhanallah al-haq. Allah, my dear sisters and my brothers, created the children of Adam. And He commanded us to follow a protocol when we go to the masjid. This is why in Surah Al-A'raf, in the ayah number 31 and the surah number 7, where there is the covenant, and Surah Al-A'raf, Allah talks beautifully to humanity. I don't know why we miss the whole boat about this. Wallahi, politics are vile and evil. They made Al-Islam just a country, just a tribe, just so local, when Al-Islam is worldwide. In that Surah Al-A'raf, Allah says, Ya Bani Adam, children of Adam, what do you think Allah is going to command us to do? He's talking to all the children of Adam, which in this case here means, and our time here in July or June the 5th or whatever, 2018, when you read this ayah, Ya Bani Adam, right today, in June 2018, Allah talks to all the children of Adam on earth. And since we all come from Adam, all those 8 billion humans on earth are spoken to by Allah this very same minute. He says, خُذُوا زِينَتَكُمْ, take your beautification, عِنْدَ كُلِّ مَسْجِدْ, to every place of prosternations. What this means is, all the children of Adam, wherever they go with the purpose to worship Allah, either in a synagogue or a church or a temple or a masjid where we go and pray, and here the masjid is not our masjid, the Muslims, is sujood. It's called the masjid because it's the place where we make sujood. Just like a mat'am is the place where we eat ta'am, marqad is the place where we sleep. So masjid is called masjid is because it's the place where we go to prostrate. We go purposefully there to prostrate. But Allah calls every place because, let's say a Hindu, when they go to their temple, yes, there is a cow, there is whatever, but when they go with the purpose, they go with the purpose to worship Allah. Yes, they got it wrong or whatever based on our understanding, but to their understanding, it's correct. And Allah deals with them. But Allah tells them, when you go there, take your beautification. And what does beautification mean? I will get back to that later when we speak about what Ibn Kathir alayhi rahmatullah says. He says, يُسْتَحَبُّ التَّجَمُّلُ عِنْدَ الصَّلَاةِ. Ibn Kathir in the tafsir of this surah ayah says, it is loved and prized to beautify when you go to a salat, especially for Jumu'ah and Eid. And then he said, وَالطِّيبُ لِأَنَّهُ مِنَ الزِّينَ, and perfume, i.e. wearing perfume, as it is part of beautification. If Allah didn't want women not to wear perfume, I'm not talking about Isha because it's dangerous time at night, it's dark and people are more vile at night. I'm talking Dhuhr, Asr, Fajr or Maghrib, and all those times where women can go out safe in the daylight and there are a lot of people in the street. Allah didn't tell women, when you go to the masjid, don't put perfume. Allah kept silent about it. Ask yourself, how much would Allah need to make it haram? 2 words. Wallahi, 2 words. That's all it's needed. But Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala kept it open because Al-Islam is universal. It's not in some Bedouin town in Saudi Arabia where the biggest sheikh there comes from and is never left from. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to emphasize the call, it's the children of Adam. And he did not say, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, O you who believe. He says, Ya bani Adam, children of Adam. And the Quran talks to humanity from the very baby who is born just now to the one who is 150 years and is about to die from now. And Allah, my dear sisters and my brothers, knows the future. And how can it not be that he doesn't know the future? أَلَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ خَلَقَ وَهُوَ اللَّطِيفُ الْخَبِيرُ. Doesn't he know what he has created? He does know. And he, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, didn't make this Islam to restrict the lives of humans by prohibiting them from things that Allah himself made halal. Is perfume halal or haram? It's halal for the love of Allah. And anyway, next to the ayah 32, like the one that comes after he made this beautiful statement, I mean when he said to take our beautification to every place of worship, Allah knew that there will be some spoilers, some party poopers that will come here and will make our life a living hell. And he knew that there will some people who will prohibit us from doing certain things that are halal. So Allah teaches us how to respond to them. So when someone comes to you and those self-appointed gods who always make this halal and that haram according to their wishes, or more so according to the wishes of their leaders and governors, guess what? When they start making things that are originally halal, they make them haram. Allah teaches us on how to respond to them, and he starts by saying, قُلْ, say to these people, مَنْ حَرَّمَ زِينَةَ اللَّهِ, who has made haram, the adornment, the beautification, the ornamentation and decorations that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala akhraja li'ibadihi, which he has brought out to his subservient, i.e. every human. Who made this halal? Who made perfume for women haram? And who restricted these things? Who told you that she only should wear it for her husband? Who told you that? It's culture. It's politics. It's closed, narrow, schizophrenic minds that have said that. Allah didn't say it, and Rasulullah ﷺ didn't say it, because Rasulullah ﷺ would never ever say something that Allah didn't say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And also then Allah teaches us to teach this ignorance, even in the banner of Islam and religion, they seem to know. But in fact, they don't know, because they always put the book of Allah behind their back. And then the following ayah, number 33, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us how to respond to the haram makers and also how to silence them. Allah commands us and he says, قُلْ, tell them again, إِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ رَبِّيَ الْفَوَاحِشِ, tell them that certainly my Lord has made haram great evil sins, or the indecencies. مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا وَمَا بَطَنَ, those committed openly or in the hidden. And then, وَالْإِثْمَ وَالْبَغْيَ بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ, al-ithm is the name for any evil that the humans do and where we get sins. And al-baghi is oppression, transgression, some attitude. People feel bigger than the others and just looking down on people. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَن تُشْرِكُوا بِاللَّهِ مَا لَمْ يُنَزِّلْ بِهِ سُلْطَانًا, and that you associate with Allah that which he has not sent down with any proof. And obviously there is nothing that that says associate to Allah. Allah is one, subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَن تَقُولُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ, and that you say about Allah that which you do not know. This ayah, 31, 32, 33, in the surah number 7, if you can memorize them, even if you can't memorize them in Arabic, memorize their meanings in English and use them every time someone comes and makes something that Allah has made halal and they make it haram, respond to them with this ayat. I'm coming to the end of the second half an hour. I will stop here, inshallah. And then I will go back to the next one and I will speak about what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the Quran about perfume and the two commands of Allah about zina and all the wrapping up, inshallah, is on part 3. Do not miss that, because the ruling about women wearing perfume will be then explained in part 3. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.